Welcome to Artflix on CBA TV. This is Muti Olawuyi. This time around, we are moving to other parts of Africa, that is West Africa again. And this time we are going to Nigeria, and we are moving to Niger Delta. When we get to the other part of the studio, we'll discuss about this in detail. See you there. Welcome back to the other part of the studio. As we've said earlier, we'll be focusing on the West African part of the globe. And this time around, we're looking at one of the most sensitive parts of Nigeria, the Niger Delta. Niger Delta, precisely, what are we going to talk about there? I will leave that for our guests to discuss about this in detail. Welcome to the show.
No, thank you very much. Thank you.
We are considering Helen Abiola's paper boat, Oil on the Water. What is the oil on the water and why this title itself?
The book is quite an interesting book. And, you know, it is not far from reality itself because it is a mirror of what is happening in the Niger Delta society of Nigeria. As you know, there has been a series of agitation in the past in Niger Delta, and although it has been, we would say, quashed now, it's not as it used to be before when it was a heavy exchange of gunfire between the militant and the military forces, you know. And, you know, before that, the pre-Yadwa days, so when it was very hot. And Helen Abiola digs deep into the circumstances or the event that may have caused the face-off between the militant and the federal government itself. You know, apart from the issue of the crossfire oil bunkering, there was also the serious issue of kidnap, which was going on, whereby expatriates were going missing by the day and heavy ransoms were paid to get them out of the clutches of the militant. So this is the issue that Helen Abiola dabbles into. And in this book, we come in contact with the major stakeholders in the whole scheme there. And we get to hear from each side, each angle, to see what is actually happening.
So before
the oil on the water is basically the contamination or the despoilation of the flora and fauna of the Niger Delta based on glass flaring or contamination of crude oil on the water, making their sustenance almost close to impossible.
So what is the paper boat?
No, the paper book is just a title I used. The paper, we are talking about the book itself.
Okay, the book itself.
It's taking us across through the areas of the Niger Delta.
Okay. Before we go deeply into this very important text, who is Helen Abiola?
Well, Helen Abiola is a prominent writer from Nigeria. He was born in 1967, I think, in Gombe State.
Okay.
And he studied English language and literature at University of Jos. And he grew up there, and after a while he had a thing in journalism, because at a point he moved to Lagos to meet his friend Tony Khan, where they both co-edited a magazine. Then after that, I think he moved outside the country, and he has taught at in the US and in Britain. So in several other places. Currently, I think he's a professor of creative writing.
But what struck me is the fact that it's not from Niger Delta. How could he write and picture the place? Because I was expecting that someone who would write such a thing
should be from
somewhere from that area.
We've had May Wunye Ifoma, I think she wrote the Oil Cemetery, and you know, with several writers, Isidore Okpo, even I think Tides was the title of the book. There are several writers who have emerged from the Niger Delta, but I think his own work strikes us particularly even more than those of the other writers that I've come in contact with. And you know, it's surprising to me too that not being from that area, he's able to capture.
He didn't study there, he wasn't born there, he doesn't have even any linkage with that in terms of historical, cultural linkage with people on the other side. And he came up with a text about another demography.
Yeah, what is happening in the Niger Delta is not is not out of this thing, out of the purview of most Nigerians. Mm-hmm. Most of us know that these are the issues that are going on. Mm-hmm. And I think kudos to him, because as an investigative journalist, he is able to dig deep into some of the circumstances that may have breeded the issues that are ongoing in that vicinity. So I think he did a lot of investigative work, and maybe somehow I also suspect that he may have worked there before as a journalist or something, or even worked in that investigative.
Oh, as a researcher.
Yeah, as a researcher.
For a short period of time.
So, and you know, his best friend, Tony Khan, is also from that area. Yeah, so exactly. There's a lot of material to use from. He has the right sources with him, so he could actually move deep. And when you look at it when you talk about JOS, that is still the middle belt. It's still close to that area we're talking about, the Niger Delta, you know, the Delta area. The creek. So it's close. So there is that issue, that interrelation between the parties. And you have to know that Elon Abila, you can't define him as a Marxist though, but he's very peculiar about the injustice and oppression that pervade the society. You know, having been born and grew up under a military government, where you have autocracy, you know, he got to know very early the true meaning of dictatorship, authoritarianism, and oppression. So his works usually focus on the downtrodden and the oppressed in the society. And that is what I think may have pushed him into the Niger Delta vicinity to study what is actually happening there, and they come up with something that appears to be a semblance of the events that are ongoing at that place.
All right, let's now go into the synopsis of what this is. Let's go deeply into the plot development of this very important creative work.
Yeah, the book was written in a fragmented style, because the stories were not just told straightforward. It wasn't chronological. It was break and join that was happening there. And perhaps it made the story even more interesting to us. Mm-hmm. It happens that the wife, Isabel, mm-hmm. Isabel James, has been killed. The wife of an expatriate, who is the expatriate is the manager of a multi-million dollar company, oil company in Nigeria, located in Niger Delta area. Okay. And his wife had visited Nigeria some months back, and suddenly she has been kidnapped. So the news is both on local and international media outlets, and it has been traced that to the militant that they kidnapped the wife. So it's more like a normal occurrence. The militants kidnapped oil expatriates, the expatriates who are into oil, the oil field, and all their family members, and demand for huge ransom to set them free. So this was what happened in this scenario too. But the problem was that the oil magnates did not know exactly which of the militant group had his wife. So many contacted him to pay ransom, but he wanted to be sure which. So he assembled a group of journalists and asked them to go investigate, meet the militant, and be sure that they have his wife with him before he pays the ransom, to be sure. So they fixed a meeting for a location called Irikefe. And the journalists were selected, and that was where the narrator of the story came into the picture, Rufus. Rufus is the narrator of the story. He's also a journalist who works with one of the local news outlets in Port Harcourt. So while there, he saw the advert for those that will volunteer to go for the trip. But most of the workers in that news outlet declined. They said they didn't want to go, because just some few weeks back, some two journalists went into the creeks and they were found dead. So they didn't come out. They didn't return back alive. So the others refused, but Rufus said he wanted to go, because there was a man amongst the team who was Zach. Zach was a prominent journalist in Nigeria, well known, famous for his daring acts, you know. So
he was inspired.
He was inspired, because Zach was actually his mentor. So he decided to volunteer, and they went there. They got to the meeting and discovered that the military had gotten there ahead of them, and the military has turned the place to rubble, because there had been an exchange of gunfire between the militant and the military. So the whole place was turning to rubble. So the meeting could not happen, because the military were trying to be zealous. They wanted to preempt the the militants and foil the ransom payment so that they can get the Isabel alive, the expatriate woman. But it didn't work like that, because by the time they got there, the whole place was destroyed. So that is where the main story started. The other journalists said, well, since the meeting can no longer hold, they have to go back to their news outlets and report. But Zach said, being a daring journalist, is that kind of adventurous journalist who has this kind of heart of bravado that he exhibits a lot. So he decided that no, the story cannot just end like that. We have to dig deep. So they decided to make their own investigation, move around. So the two of them got a boat with a fisherman and his son, and they began moving around the creeks to try to locate the woman herself, Isabel. In the process of moving around, they came across one of the tribes of the Niger Delta who have been displaced because the government was interested in their land. So they couldn't get access. They were forced out of their land because they refused to accept money for the land to be sold. So they had to be thrown out of that land, and they became vagrants, moving from one place to the other. So the tribe narrated their ordeal to Zach and Rufus, and it was a pathetic experience, because when you know that because of you refuse to give up your own ancestral land, the government brings in the military and force you out of that environment. So this is particularly one of the issues that has called for the desperation amongst the youth of the Niger Delta, later joined the militant gang. So now, apart from that, there is that issue of the contamination of the water, where fishermen, people who have long time, even before this, since the ancient days, they've been fishing in that water. But now the water is contaminated. The fishes are dying, and they can no longer obtain their livelihood from there. And when you talk about the soil, whatever you plant on the soil doesn't grow. And not only just the fishes and the crops. You also talk about the animals. You know, he described the scene where there was a certain point in time where bats fly at night. Yeah. But because of the constant gas flaring, most of those bats are running away from that vicinity. They don't want to be there anymore. So when you are confronted with this kind of situation, that situation, you know, people tend to take certain steps to make a change in their life. So apart from, you know, when we saw those ones, we also met with the military, head of a military unit, coordinating the affairs of the federal government in that area, who was in charge of the security. And from there, we saw the way he was treating those that are arrested, the militants. You know, he would pour petrol on them, punish them for this, put them in jail without food, and the way he was treating them. And purposely he was sent there because he had an issue. He himself appeared to be a sadist, because I think at the time, the story was that his daughter was raped, so he went and killed the daughter of the man who raped the daughter. Yeah. So when it was done, he was taken to court, and the military decided that rather than send him away or punish him or court martial him, they decided to send him to Niger Delta as punishment. So he came there with a vengeance, and he was exerting that vengeance on the populace of Niger Delta. If he catches you, even with you are a suspected criminal, not even confirmed, he will treat you like a true criminal and punish you. He brings them out for parade every morning, pours petrol on them, put them in the sun to dry for the petrol to dry on their skin. So that was what they were going through then. And then again, as he goes through the creeks, then later again he meets the militant. He was able to meet the militant, and from that confrontation he gets to know that they actually have the white woman with them, because they were able to trace the white woman to one of the village, and the militant got her arrested because she escaped, and they got her arrested again. So the leader of the militant was called Professor. And Professor, though he may appear illiterate, but he was sure of his demands. So he told Rufus to write the right thing, what is happening, tell the world about what we are suffering, tell them about what is going on in our society, and make sure that there is a change. Don't go and tell lies, tell the truth. That was the challenge. He gave him the challenge of what true journalism should be about. So, and Rufus was more like in the story content with documenting what happened. He was not an active participator.
Yeah, he's just an observer.
Yeah, he's an observer, getting details. And, you know, at the end of the day, it's like he's leaving us the
true
reader.
Zach.
Leaving us the reader to make assumptions of what is right or what is wrong. So it's more like
that's why I said that the book reporter.
Yeah, the book benefited a lot from Elon Abila's experience as a journalist because it was written like a journalistic report, getting facts from various angles. You know, we meet all the stakeholders, the villagers who have been displaced, we meet the militants, we meet the military officers, and the journalists also participate. Then also, we meet some group of worshippers who don't want to be part of the whole thing. They are just content with worshipping the sun and the water. That was what they didn't want to be part of the whole scenario, but somehow their location was also destroyed. They are affected because you cannot be there and not be part of it.
All right, let's go for a break. When we come back, we'll continue from where we stop. All right, see you there.
Welcome to QETC Qalam Educational and Technical Center.
I am Ahmed Mohammed Ahmed. I am a student of Qalam Educational and Technical Center.
Qalam Educational and Technical Center is a place that you can improve your English language.
I came with zero English. Now I'm better.
Come to Qalam Educational and Technical Center. This will help you to improve your English, your listening, your speaking, your writing and reading.
If you want to speak confidently without fearing, come and join Qalam and learn how to speak in front of thousand people without fear.
Welcome back from the break. We were talking about a very important text, oil and water. From the way you've been getting this message so far, you must have noticed that people are suffering a lot. It's not only in Nigeria, even other parts of the globe, particularly where they have the resources and they don't have the power to control the resources. This is really, really affecting the people. And it has really damaged the future of most people in those areas. And we can see from the way this narration is going on, we've seen people who are directly or indirectly affected, those who are just pessimistic, or those who believe in status quo. It is like this, we just have to do it that way. This is what Nabila is trying to convey to the world, that we have people who are one way or the other affected, but their approach to getting things solved is different. They don't use the same approach. Some just believe in just calling on God to rescue them. Other ones don't have any alternative other than to move out of their base. Some have to use a military approach to coerce those oppressors to get themselves down and get something to get for their own family to survive. These are the militants you're talking about. All right, let's take it from where you stop. You were talking about the people who worship the sun and the water, regarding the caring not about whether they are directly affected or not. What happened on that area?
You know, at the end of the day, there also their place was destroyed. But towards the end of the story, it was revived. They kept their continue that same way, worshiping the sun and the water, and trying to be out of the fray. But you know, in the long run, it cannot leave anyone out. Yeah. Once you are there and it's going on there, definitely it will get to you. At the end of the day, the woman was safe. She was released after her husband was able to pay the ransom. She went back to her husband. But the troubles in Niger Delta did not continues. Yes, in the story. So, you know, realistically, we can say that when the Yadua government came, they were able to achieve amnesty. With that, and a lot of things were resolved. Drafted. Some of the militants were drafted into scholarship schemes and the rest of like that. So most of them had the opportunity to become better. So and since then, we've heard less of the issues that is troubling them. But you know, peculiarly about that area seems to have an history of agitations and if you remember vividly in the colonial days, we had King Jaja Fukubu. Then it was a issue of oil, not really palm oil. which was a problem. The palm oil trade, where the colonialists wanted to control, and that area was a very fertile ground for palm oil to harvesting, and the colonial government wanted to control the white people wanted to control the supply of the oil. They wanted to buy directly from the from traders, and Jaja Kubo stood and said, no way, you can't do that, you can't boycott me, I'm the middleman here.
Yeah.
And then they had to arrest him and take him away. The same happened to Vorame of Benin. It was still the issue of trade and exploitation. And you know, apart from that, there was also, I think, I don't remember his name. Is it Nana of Cherokee? No. There was another Niger Delta leader too that was also like that. And you move from there, move to the days of Isaac Adakaboro, and now the days of oil. You still have the same agitation. It's like there's a problem seriously in that area. Things just keep getting odd or hourly for them. It doesn't.
But one thing you will also find out there is that the story is changing now. From the external exploiting internal the owners, from the visitor exploiting the host, we now have the host exploiting the rest of the host. That's what we are having now.
You know,
and the visitor indirectly now using some members of the host to exploit them and get them.
That is what I wanted to point out.
The concept of imperialism.
That is what is going on now. Most of those oil companies are owned by expatriates, foreigners.
Yeah.
They are not. They are owned by foreign companies and countries. They are not Nigerian based. And this crude oil is being extracted from there
and managed by the Niger Deltans themselves.
No, you have
those who are on top.
Yeah, you have, but you have very few of them, and that's part of the agitations they are facing there. They can't understand why there should be oil companies in their place, and there are people who are not benefiting much from it. Many of them are not able to secure employment there, but you cannot as well blame them. I think the rate of education is also a bit poor there, and that is where the government needs to do something. And you know, when you even talk about these people, have state governments who get allocation from the oil.
They also have local government.
Nothing is being done with that money. The money just goes into individual pockets, and
that's exactly where I'm going.
That is where the youth are still agitating to today, because the basic necessities of life which you are supposed to provide, you are not providing as a government or institution. And when the people talk, you threaten them with the powers, with the soldiers or the police, and you think that it will just die down like that. No, you don't settle things like that. It has to be a win-win thing for everybody. If you are excavating oil from that area, then there should be something that goes back to the people. You can't just leave them jobless, destroy their means of livelihood, and expect them to keep quiet. Sooner or later, if the old ones are not able to retaliate or fight back, the younger ones would wake up and say, no, we cannot take this. And that is what is happening. The youth, as from the age of 16, 17, 18, they begin to join militant groups.
Even before that.
Yeah, so that
because,
is...
Because any place that is prone to war or crisis, you must expect...
Child soldiers,
you know, drug addicts, you know,
yeah.
who are ready to do anything. Some of them are even injected to get involved in such. You see, you see the kind of revenge boiling in them. Maybe perhaps the soldiers you mentioned in the text might have mistakenly killed one of their dearest persons.
No, that is the way.
Now will resort to retaliation.
To
go and attack or destroy the property. Some of them are not even interested in the money anymore. They want to destroy what is making them to kill their people. You know. So, and that is on the part of those who are controlling. It's very sad. Those, we have the local government, you have the state government, before it gets to even federal government. And the allocation given to the states is not the same as the one given to other states who do not have. So the resources should have been enough to take those people in particular. They don't do that. Would they just give either the king, you know, the head of the local heads, you know,
selective
a few of them,
selective remuneration.
Close the chapter from there.
That's what the oil companies are doing. The oil company will go to a place and rather than interact directly with the people, they interact with the chiefs, and the chiefs keep getting fat at the expense of the people. And when there's a revolution or a revolt in that area, the chiefs will not be there to stand for them.
And if they're unable to even now control the entire, the serious lessons affecting them, they look at the head of that militant, you know, militant group,
and try to pull him up.
Penetrate him with money, bribe him, and get him all what he feels is will make him to live a paradisical world. And he forgets about his people again. Thus, they become pompous, you know, start messing up with the people, using their own people to get what they want. And anytime they want to get something, they find a way of getting to, they have a way of meeting the company. But those ones don't have the channel to communicate with the company directly. And whatever message they convey to them is what they are going to believe. And that's exactly what is happening in that setting. I believe Helen Habila has been able to capture as a reporter.
Yeah, as a reporter, the true
scenario. Like you are watching a film, a movie, you know, just reporting, getting this is what's happening here on this area, these people are facing this kind of lifestyle. What exactly is the key message this writer wants to achieve?
I think he wants to bring the story to light because most people don't understand what is going on. They are focused on the one-sided propaganda by the federal government. And you know, we cannot, the whole thing we are saying here cannot be complete without mentioning the likes of Ken Saro-Wiwa, who an environmentalist, right?
Yeah, he was killed in Obodoku, Oji River area.
You see, so. These people, there has been that history of agitation for long in that area, and people don't know what is on the table. So Helen Habila is bringing up the issues, and you can see one thing you are going to appreciate about him if you read that book is the power of description in the book. He is able to give us a vivid description. You can barely close your eyes like this and even see or imagine the picture of the water with the oil spillage on top of the water, the deaths of fishes just lying floating dead on the water, whereby it cannot be eaten and it's useless. It's there just wasting away. So those are the things he's able to picture. How villages that were once trade communities, they are used as a local market for the people, became deserted. And you know, people, because of the oil extraction, people could no longer live there. You know, it was no longer conducive for their health. And even a doctor revealed to us in the story that oil extraction was having some series of medical implications for the people. Some certain kind of diseases that were not there before were coming into that that area. So these are the things, these are the issues that Helen Habila wants us to look into and see that, yes, these things are happening really, and this is why these people are agitating, right? But he didn't really take sides, but he also should, because he showed us also other parts of other stakeholders, right? That's why I said the characters in the story can be classified into at least six. You have the exploiters who are represented by the oil company and their workers, that is the expatriates there. You have the oppressors, which is the government and those that work hand in hand with the government, the police or the security agencies working for the government. Those are the group of oppressors. Then you have the oppressed, which are the people, right? You have amongst the oppressed, you have those who have decided to just watch and do nothing, like the Irekeve listen. They show a kind of non-alignment participation in the story. They want to be out of the story. We also get to hear their own view of what is going on in the story too. And we have those who have resigned to fate and decide that yes, we are not going to do anything about it. It has happened. We only just keep moving. Once they come to us, we move away from there and move to another place. So that is the aspect, the things that we see in that story. So Helen Habila is passing the message of what that there needs to be a solution. He did not provide any solution during the story. He's just content with depicting what is happening and showing us from all angles, not just a one-sided affair. So, and from there, we as readers are left to make our own judgment. And if you ask me, I think I will be on the side of the Niger Delta people, because I what I saw there is enough to make even shed tears from what you see in the story, the destruction or despoliation of the environment. You know, it is what every environmentalist should be afraid of, that this is what is happening here. Places that were once forests became barren lands. You know, it's unfortunate. And you know, Helen Habila is not the only one in this talking about this issue. You have people who are from Niger Delta who have said a lot about it. If you talk about Tanuri Ojaide, the poet in the US today, his poems always talk about the environmental despoliation. Isidore in tights also has a book called Tights. Talk about the same thing. In fact, he captured the inception of the agitations that came to be at this thing. And we also had May Wunye Ifeoma. She wrote Oil Cemetery, and she was once
even John Pepe Clark wrote.
So
the Wife Revolts.
Wife Revolts is even about the old oil, palm oil.
You talk about that from the beginning.
So that is these are things that people have been saying a lot. But I think Ellen Abila brought the modern issue to the fore. We are able to see what is actually happening at the present time.
But what I found out is that most of them don't usually provide solution. They are not like this South African writer who relocated from South Africa and bring another environment to solve the problem in South Africa. Most of the writers
Not most. There are those who
particularly with regards to this same they just show their anger in the writing, display the problem. But they don't show the solution to the problem.
We have two types of realist writer. We have the critical realist and just the ones that are content with depicting. So even Chinua Achebe falls into the
majority of
the show, but there are those who go ahead to still tell us that these are the steps that needs to be.
But with regards to issue that is affecting, this is my concern, issue that is affecting these Niger Deltans, what you will notice is that they only convey their anger, they convey the problem within the system, but they don't provide a solution. That is why up to now,
I think
we still keep having the.
I think we need to look at
this. Like, look at this identifying the solution.
Where we need to.
It's only leaving it for the public to think about.
What we need to look at is the fact that identifying a problem is part of the solution.
How many people almost all of them, if you check all the stories from that end,
they don't have a creative way
to come up with solution.
I think it's the right job of a writer. A writer should be able to identify the issues in society.
And then?
Right? He doesn't have the idea of solution. It should be left with the decision makers. They are the one. Because even if
they
suggest,
they are not the ones to give the problem.
At the table
government
officials
they
to
should
decide.
Provide the solution. But they should at least show how that can be resolved.
But if you don't know there's a problem, how do you provide solutions?
No, after identifying the problem,
he has been able to.
When you get after the climax, you get to anticlimax, there must be denouement. Denouement is not dealt with. There's nothing like resolution in that part.
The denouement for the story, not for the solution to
that's
the main
exactly
problem
what I'm
talking
saying.
About.
But in the story, what I'm saying is, you don't just convey problem every time. You must always also at least provide solution to the problem.
Yeah, I understand. If you read May Wunye Ifeoma's Oil Cemetery, she provides solution. She at the end of the story, the oil companies began interacting with the people directly. They were building hospitals for them, building schools for them.
That's I'm talking
in
about.
In that novel. Right.
Well,
Even if you ask me, I think the non-partisan stance of the author icks me. I'm not content with it because I expected him to be the main character the narrator to be an active participator.
Yeah, exactly.
But the narrator was just content in stories from here. But nonetheless, I think he has done a good job
by
telling us that this is where the issue lies. Then
let's
look for a way forward. So you can't do it all. You only do your part and let the rest be.
So if he's going to write chapter 2, version 2 of
I think somebody else should keep it should be a related
anyway,
it should
thank
be just
you
one
so
man.
Much for exploring this wonderful text.
You're welcome.
I'm sure we must have gained one or two things. We know more about Niger Delta for those of us who don't know about it. We know more about the challenges these people are facing, and it is very obvious one. It is dogs eating dogs and exploited by the foreigners, that mean the outsiders who call themselves the expatriates. They don't call themselves exploitators. This is just word of mouth. Something has to be done to rescue these people. When we meet next time, you'll get to know more about other parts of the world. Whether there are challenges or things that are smooth in that area, you get to know. See you then.